This week, the S&P 500 blasted to yet another all-time record, and the gold advance gained momentum, finishing at a multi-month record. Hello, everyone. Your host, Chris Walczek, back with you this weekend. We have two must-hear guests lined up for you. Most investors assume that the Fed is pulling the market strings. Well, that might not be the case, says the head of Kirby Analytics. The Fed is merely a puppet of a more nefarious institution, the Exchange Stabilization Fund. Rob Kirby says the U.S. Treasury runs the ESF, manipulating any market it chooses, even equities and gold. He agrees with John Williams, hyperinflation is inevitable, and it could result with a lofty silver price approaching four digits. Then Peru Saxena of Peru Saxena Wealth Management rejoins the show. He says that gold, silver, and related equities have moved above key technical resistance levels. He's turned bullish on the sector, due in part to U.S. dollar weakness. The top money manager thinks that silver will significantly outperform gold once investors regain their affinity for the metals. Plus, Robert Ian wraps up the show with his latest must-hear report. And folks, if you like our show, please consider supporting us with a monthly or annual subscription to the Alpha Stocks newsletter. I can't promise that every one of our candidates will be a winner in your portfolio, but we did have seven or eight this week that performed quite well. One was up 140% in one day from the entry point to the zenith. So you can sign up at our webpage or just send me a request, gsr@hughes.net, and I'll send over a link. GoldSeek.com radio begins now with the Market Weatherman Report. Mostly sunny weather appeared over the precious metals exchanges this week on continued U.S. dollar sluggishness and safe haven buying amid turmoil between Ukraine and Russia. After falling under key support last week, the greenback failed at each attempt to regain support, closing in a precarious position, vulnerable to capitulation. The news puts support under gold, which typically trades inversely with the dollar. At Friday's closing bell on the New York COMEX exchange, the yellow metal added about $11, finishing at $13.40. Silver dropped about 40 cents, ending at $20.90, down less than 2% for the week. Palladium gained about $40, up 5%, finishing at $7.82. And as I mentioned last week, the chart of palladium looked bullish. Well, it was a rocket ship this week. Platinum fared well, adding 2.5%, up about 37, closing at $14.83. Of course, Russia is one of the top global producers of palladium and platinum, so investors are a bit unnerved by the geopolitical tensions between that nation and the Ukraine over Crimea. And then West Texas Intermediate crude ended near the break-even level at about $102 a barrel. On the domestic news front, according to the Labor Department, the U.S. added 175,000 jobs in February, topping expectations, but the curveball was on the unemployment rate to 6.7%, up from 6.6%. That's one of the first increases in a while. At the last Fed meeting, officials reduced toxic bond purchases by another $10 billion a month, leaving the number at $65 billion. Still, the Fed's balance sheet continues its sharp ascent, nearly $4.2 trillion now in junk debt and treasuries on their books. While the media is downplaying the event, the increase in unemployment, I think, is big news for the precious metals. The tick higher in the rate is stimulus positive, and, of course, that's good news for gold and silver. The surprise in the jobless rate also offered the Fed breathing room, because the new Fed chair reiterated the plan to maintain QE until the national employment rate drops to 6.5%. In a strange turn of events, the mainline media is spinning the tiny increase in labor participation as the end of a downtrend. Well, not so fast. The chart looks like a locomotive going off a mountain cliff that just hit a boulder. That's not enough to stop the decline. The train will soon continue tumbling down, so stay tuned. Turning to geopolitical news, the U.S. and its allies warned of sanctions against Russia on news of the incursion into Ukraine's Crimea. Ukraine refused to compromise on the future of Crimea as Moscow agreed to honor its vote on the Black Sea region joining Russia. Investors eyed gold as a safe haven investment amid the tensions amid what could be viewed as the worst confrontation between the West and related allies with Russia since the end of the Cold War. Elsewhere, domestic demand for the yellow metal remains red hot. The gold ETF holdings increased sharply, climbing to the highest level in 3 weeks, higher by 7 tons, that's 1,750 in total. The first monthly gain since December of 2012, that's over a year, according to a Bloomberg.com report. Consumers snapped up jewelry in bars, according to one industry insider who expects that trend to persist for the rest of this year, adding more support under the metals. Bottom line on the precious metals. Well, you know, the technical situation continues to improve, with gold blasting above resistance points, such as the 50-week moving average, and finding support for the first time in exactly 1 year to the week. For next week's forecast and all the stock pick candidates, please log into your Alpha Stocks newsletter account. Moving on to the Wall Street Report, visibility was virtually unlimited over the New York Stock Exchange this week in the wake of worse-than-expected unemployment numbers. Investors viewed the report as QE positive, adding liquidity to the markets. For the week, the Dow added about 131 points, ending at 16,452. The S&P 500 added exactly 1%, up about 19 points, ending at 1878, also a new high. And the NASDAQ closed at yet another 15-year high point, picking up 28 points, ending at 4336. Well, Fed Governor William Dudley said publicly that he would like to end the 6.5% unemployment rate goal and begin raising rates. But then later he contradicted his comments, noting that the economy still has problems. Richard Fisher, another president of the Federal Reserve Bank from Dallas, he noted concerns of the U.S. stock market's eye-popping levels, he calls them, and the possible market bubble. And then Philadelphia Fed President Charles Plosser supported his colleague's thoughts, noted that ending QE and related low interest rate policies will be difficult. The next Fed meeting is slated for March 18th and 19th. The European Central Bank also left rates unchanged, and the ECB head noted that the accommodative monetary policy is showing some signs of progress. Bottom line on Wall Street. Well, the 7-component fear index finally has reached extreme levels, suggesting that the typical investor is convinced that happy days are here again and we're in the money. Of course, our listeners are far too astute to fall for those antics. One significant technical divergence is seen in the Dow, which did not confirm the new highs set in the S&P and the NASDAQ. For the rest of this report and all the stock picks, log into your Alpha Stocks newsletter account, please. And coming up after the break, more GoldSeek.com radio with Rob Kirby and Peru Saxena. We'd like for you to stay with us here at GoldSeek. Okay, it's great to be back with you at GoldSeek.com radio for another Gold Nugget segment with Rob Kirby from Kirby Analytics. Well, my next guest says that the markets are manipulated. Free markets, not with the Exchange Stabilization Fund, the most powerful institution in the country, if not the world, that tells even the almighty U.S. Fed what to do. It's a pleasure to welcome Rob Kirby in his debut appearance on GoldSeek.com radio. He runs Kirby Analytics and top advisor to institutional investors. Welcome, Rob Kirby.
Nice to be with you, Chris.
Well, you know, let's start up today, if we could, with the Exchange Stabilization Fund. We were talking before this interview about this entity that not many folks read about, even in the gold crowd, and you've got some must-hear information about this entity and the related cabal.
Sure. Let's start at the beginning, Chris. The real nitty-gritty that I've come to learn about the Exchange Stabilization Fund, And I would recommend all your listeners to go to a website called marketskeptics.com. And marketskeptics.com was the creation of a chap by the name of Eric DeCarbonell. And Eric DeCarbonell, his great-grandfather was a fellow by the name of Frank Vanderlip. And Frank Vanderlip was one of the people who rode the secret train down to Jekyll Island back in the early 1900s, and he was one of the original framers of the Federal Reserve Act. So Mr. DeCarbonell has a history of knowing a fair amount about the inner workings of central banking it's hard to tell the difference between the Federal Reserve these days and the U.S. Treasury operations, because the two of them seem to work hand in hand in terms of their market operations or their I'm going to say their nefarious market operations. So anyway, Mr. Carbonell, he created a video series back about 3 years ago, a five-part video series. It's linked on his site, marketskeptics.com. And this five-part series is very powerful, and like I said, I'd recommend anybody watch it. And it basically cemented, or was the glue or the mortar that really erected the bigger foundation of my understanding of the interplay between the U.S. Treasury acting with the Fed. The Exchange Stabilization Fund is a covert arm of the U.S. Treasury that does not publish any financial reports. It is beyond the purview of Congress. It answers to nobody but the president. This Secretary of the Treasury is charged with running it, and it answers to nobody but the president. So there's no congressional oversight of this. Historically, it's been documented that the Exchange Stabilization Fund operates in any market, including the equity markets, anything and everything. And they literally are not held to account of any laws as set out in the U.S. Constitution or the laws of land. And this entity was seeded. It was created in 1934. It was seeded originally with $3 billion. And if you want to think in terms of a criminal enterprise that was set up in 1934, if you just use in your head some natural compounding with published, even with published inflation rates, you know that $3 billion in 1934 dollars is worth a considerable sum today, especially when you factor in the notion that these people pay no tax and they publish no financials. So anyway, this entity has grown to be an incredibly powerful financial entity. And as the Carbonell's work points out, they are, at least in my view, they are without a doubt the most powerful financial entity on the planet.
Let's talk about just how powerful they are in the markets and what gives them their power. Now, you did mention this $3 billion, which is probably somewhere in the neighborhood of at least $100 billion today, and who knows how much larger. I wonder if you could tell us a bit more about the Exchange Stabilization Fund and how they manipulate interest rate swaps, as well as this direct connection that you alluded to with the U.S. Treasury Department.
Chris, when you're talking about the Exchange Stabilization Fund, you are talking about the U.S. Treasury. When the Exchange Stabilization Fund operates in markets, in any market, they use, let's say, the good offices of the New York Federal Reserve, and specifically the New York Fed Trading Desk acts as the exclusive broker for the Exchange Stabilization Fund. So when the Exchange Stabilization Fund wants to operate in OTC swaps, or an OTC means over-the-counter swaps, and OTC swaps are nothing but, let's just call it, custom-designed bets on interest rates at a future date. And the OTC swaps, broken down into their constituents, are at the short end of the curve, they are FRAs, or future rate agreements, and then at the longer end of the curve, they are interest rate swaps. An FRA is a bet, is basically a glorified bet on what a specific LIBOR rate is going to be somewhere between now and 1 year forward. And an interest rate swap is an exchange of fixed for floating interest rate payments. And interest rate swaps from 3 years to 10 years in duration typically almost always have a bond trade embedded in them, because these swaps, 3 to 10 years, interest rate swaps 3 to 10 years, trade as a spread over U.S. government bonds, and that is why there is a bond trade embedded in the swap. Banks, when commercial banks or bank holding companies operate in the interest rate swap market, they are always going to be spreading. As in, they don't gamble on all-in rates. They don't gamble on the, like, if, for instance, if a 10-year bond is yielding 2.65 or 2.69, I think it is today, the bank that's going to trade or going to operate in the 10-year swap space, they aren't betting on the whole 2.69 absolute rate. What they're going to bet on is where banks trade credit, because banks all trade at a spread over where the government can basically borrow money. And the government, the yield curve of government bonds is referred to as the risk-free rate of, risk-free rate of interest. And the theory behind that is always that governments will always at least print the money and give it back to you, so you're always safe to buy a government bond, because they have the power of taxation, they have the power to create money, and they're always going to at least print the money and give it back to you. Banks pay a premium to what the government can raise money at, and it's that spread that's managed when you trade interest rate swaps. And hence, there is a bond trade embedded. When Bank A trades a 10-year swap with Bank B in the interbank market, the Bank B, if they're the receiver of the fixed rate, sells a notional amount of bonds in the cash market to the payer of fixed. And what happens when the exchange stabilization fund comes into the market, they operate one way only. They operate as a receiver of all in fixed rates, and they do not provide the fixed rate paying bank, spread playing bank, they do not provide them with the bonds to hedge their trade. This forces the spread paying bank into the cash bond market to buy bonds to hedge their trade. This creates phantom demand effectively for government bonds.
We thought we had the creature from Jekyll Island by our Federal Reserve and, of course, the Fed chair, who is essentially appointed and then has to give an occasional speech before Congress. That's who we thought was the nefarious Wizard of Oz pulling the strings. But in reality, he has a big brother. And this big brother has virtually no oversight whatsoever with endless deep pockets. Can you tell us just what this means to the everyday investor? Are you essentially saying that the markets are rigged?
I'm saying the markets are rigged. I'm saying that interest rates and the level that we see interest rates at today is 100% arbitrary. It's not based in economics. Everything that economics teaches you is that the market rates of interest, or the risk-free rate of interest, call it the 10-year bond rate, the U.S. 10-year government bond rate, is supposed to be the real inflation rate plus about 250 points. And, you see, this is all part of why the government has to tell us that the inflation, they doctor the inflation statistics to tell us that inflation's running below 2%. If you go and look at the work of John Williams, who's a brilliant economist in his own right, and if you look at his work says that if we were measuring today the inflation rate the same way it was measured in 1980, instead of having inflation at 1.8 or 1.6%, we would indeed have an inflation rate close to 10%. By the metric I just mentioned, that would put 10-year government money, 10-year bond yield, call it 9.5% plus 250 points. That would be 12% 10-year money. So you see, they had to doctor the inflation number to make the inflation look like it didn't exist, and this way they can hopefully try to justify why 10-year bonds are at 2.95%. So, you know, like, the reality is they are completely and 100% arbitrarily set. They're set in the back rooms by people at the U.S. Treasury acting in concert with the Federal Reserve, and then the rates are forced to these levels by using interest rate derivatives, FRAs, and interest rate swaps, and U.S. monetary policy is executed with the Federal Reserve acting as broker. and executed through the trading desks of what I like to refer to as the Magnificent Five. And that would be J.P. Morgan, Citibank, Bank of America, Goldman Sachs, and Morgan Stanley. Each one of these five cretinous institutions has a derivatives book in excess of $50 trillion notional. And these numbers are so staggering, Chris, like, you know, nobody will debate me on the size of their books. Nobody wants to talk about it.
Well, the irony of that is that you have just made an excellent segue into my next question for you. I was going to ask you about the top five U.S. banks and their 200 plus trillion in notional derivatives. Now, here's the big question, though. Derivatives are not necessarily de facto risky. However, interest rate derivatives are particularly so. What would you estimate their interest rate exposure, top five U.S. banks?
To begin with, Chris, now the number that you're looking at, you've probably gone to the quarterly derivatives report of the Office of the Comptroller of the Currency. And you're probably looking, when you just gave me the aggregate number of $200 trillion in notional at the top five U.S. banks, that's actually a very misleading number. Because in the quarterly derivatives report, Chris, I think there's about 31 pages in those reports, roughly 31, it might be 32 pages. Every page but one gives you data on the top 25 commercial banks in the United States. But there's one page that gives you the total aggregates for the bank holding companies in the United States. And there's a big difference between the two. Because when you count bank holding companies, the total aggregate held by U.S. institutions goes from $200 trillion up to about $300 trillion. So the real number we're talking here is $300 trillion. And what's $100 trillion between friends? The big difference there being, or the most pronounced difference between holding companies and commercial banks, is that Morgan Stanley trades all their derivatives in the name of the bank holding company, not the commercial bank. And their book is over $50 trillion. And then of Goldman Sachs' book, I believe it's $6 trillion additional. The commercial bank Goldman Sachs has a derivatives book, for instance, of $44 trillion, but at the holding company level, it's $50. And you see, so the numbers that we get from the Office of the Comptroller of the Currency in the quarterly derivatives reports, they are useful, but you have to understand that they aren't by any means complete.
Duly noted. With that in mind, though, I think you'd probably agree that the interest rate exposure is a key metric. Can you tell us what you estimate that to be out of the figure and just what it could mean if suddenly, oh, I don't know, the world lost faith and confidence in the U.S. dollar and some of those few trillions of dollars started to repatriate back to our shores?
Here's a great way to look at it. If you look at the total aggregates, The Office of the Comptroller of the Currency does tell us on a breakdown of percentages that 82% of all derivatives held by U.S. banks or banking entities, over 80% of this exposure is in interest rate contracts. And then interest rate contracts would be broken down into OTC swaps, which is the lion's share of that 82% of the aggregate. But it would also have such things as exchange-traded futures like euro-dollar futures, and it would have things like options on euro-dollar futures. So there is a segment of it that's exchange-traded, but the amount of this stuff that is the amount of this stuff that's traded OTC is by far the lion's share of it, and measuring the risk in it. I used to be an institutional broker in this stuff back in the 80s, and back in the 80s, I was a broker to an institution called Citibank Canada Toronto, and Citibank Canada Toronto is where these instruments were incubated back in the 80s, and there's a bit of a story as to why they were developed and incubated in Canada, but it had something to do with our Bank Act and the protectionism by Canadian banks. But in any case, these instruments were incubated in Canada, and Citibank Canada was the clearinghouse for Citibank Worldwide in the 80s. In derivative instruments, the variability I know in my client's position on a volatile day in the interest rate universe, he could have swings in his P&L of many millions of dollars, and I'm talking like on a book size that probably would have been measured in the hundreds of billions. So all I'm saying is it's a percentage. You can have variability because these interest rate derivatives are dynamic, and because most banks will tell you that they are somewhat hedged when they put these trades on, and then as the market gets crazy and if interest rates start whipping around, the value of the hedges change. And you see, so like to think that if you had a $50 trillion derivatives book, to think that you could have a 1% variability in the value of that book on a very upsetting day in the marketplace, 1% of $50 trillion is $500 billion, and that's more than the market capitalization of any U.S. bank.
Okay, let's bring this back then, if we could. I'd like to know just how this exchange stabilization fund manages, you say, not only interest rates, but our equities markets and even the precious metals markets, please.
Chris, interest rates and specifically the price of gold, are historically co-joined at the hip. And, you know, people don't have to take my word for it. You can take the word of a former U.S. Treasury Secretary by the name of Lawrence Summers. Mr. Summers did academic work as a professor at Harvard University back in the 1980s. He penned a paper called Gibson's Paradox and the Gold Standard with a fellow professor at the time at Harvard.
Exactly. It shows that when we have negative interest rates, we tend to have very bullish gold markets. It's quite a famous paper in the industry. Yep.
It makes the connection between making the philosophical argument or discussion that you wouldn't be able to rig rates down unless you could rig the price of gold down too, because the gold price would effectively serve as the canary in the coal mine and would start squawking that something is amiss in the interest rate market. And you see, this is what gold has been trying to do for the past 15 or 20 years. And it's been short-circuited. It's been short-circuited through floods of paper gold selling on exchanges like the COMEX exchange and through the London Bullion Market Association, where promises of gold are sold in lieu of actual physical gold itself.
But if that's the case, has the canary stopped chirping? Has it fallen off the perch? How much time is left before, you know, the natural forces, the invisible hand, as Adam Smith would call it, exerts influence over these markets?
You see, Chris, what this has served to do is, you know, when you run a skimming operation, Chris, and I sort of can equate this a little bit to a skimming operation. When you run a skimming operation and you skim a little bit, sometimes not everybody in the room gets it or notices. But when the skimming operation becomes bigger and bigger and bigger, people around you start to notice. And you see, the rest of the world has really started to notice, particularly the Asians, particularly China. They're very aware, and the Germans, I think, are also very aware now, as are the Russians. They're extremely aware of what America's been doing in terms of turning our capital markets into forgeries of what they're supposed to be. And you see, this is why China has been, you know, in the last two or three years, I think they've completed something like 22 or 23 bilateral swap agreements with totaling like $2.5 trillion roughly with fellow trading partners, with the expressed point of excluding U.S. dollars from from a global trade settlement.
And then I know the listener out there is scratching their head saying, you know, we've read these reports. Chris has been talking about it. His guests have been talking about it. All of these interconnections away from the dollar. Agreements with Iran between China. Agreements throughout the BRIC nations. Then how is it that this U.S. dollar continues to keep from breaking below that key 70-71 point?
Through derivatives. It's held up. It's held up because, to a large extent, Chris, banks that play in these derivatives become dollar junkies, because the act of doing these trades mean that the banks involved in them need dollars. And it's not just U.S. banks that are involved in the derivatives markets. You see, because as we said earlier, like the Bank for International Settlements, they also put out derivative statistics, and they tell us that global derivatives total of around $750 trillion. I think the last time I saw their numbers, and we've just established earlier that American banks only make up $300 trillion of that. So that means there's another $350 trillion that would be spread out among, let's just say, some British banks, probably some Japanese banks, probably at least one German bank, like namely Deutsche, Hong Kong Shanghai Bank. There'd be a couple of French banks. There's probably a big Dutch bank. And these guys all have books in the trillions, you know, many tens of trillions also. And the fact that they have these books and they have commitments in dollars means that all of these banks of all these different nationalities can't just drop dollars, because they're contractually committed. By, like, when you do a 10-year swap with a counterparty, you have an exchange of dollar-denominated funds for the next 10 years. So you just can't drop the dollar and say we're not going to do dollars anymore, because you're obligated.
If it's true, as you say, that gold is being manipulated lower as well as interest rates, if we do start to see a significant increase or pickup in interest rates, it would seem that that might not crush the precious metals as much as one would expect. That we could actually see, as we did in the 70s, interest rates inch up sharply along with the precious metals markets.
Interest rates are never going appreciably higher. And, you know, like we might see the 10-year drift up to 3%. It might drift up to 3% again, but I'm even thinking that's probably not likely now either. Because, you see, through the interest rate swap mechanism, they have the ability to make the 10-year bond yield anything they want it to be. You see, in days gone by, Chris, there was these people known as bond vigilantes, and bond vigilantes used to inflict discipline on the bond market. If they saw government spending or printing too much money, they would sell their debt and they would raise the level of interest that the government had to pay, which would curb the government's spendthriftness. But you see, the bond vigilantes are as extinct. They died like 10, 15 years ago. They were all wiped out, because what they did when they saw the government turning on the reckless fiscal, perpetual fiscal deficits, they started to sell the bonds. And that's when the exchange stabilization fund stepped in, and they realized that they could combat these people by doing these interest rate swaps with the banks in the marketplace, which would turn the banks into captive buyers of U.S. government debt to the tune of any amount they want them to be. So you see, they basically had their debt problem solved. And this is why, Chris, if you read the memoirs of Paul O'Neill, when he was talked to by Dick Cheney back in the early 00s, he went to O'Neill and he said, deficits don't matter anymore. It's our due. We can spend whatever we want. You see, Cheney, as the consummate backroom guy, he knew that they had the ability to make the amount of spending that the U.S. government was doing irrelevant, and that they could control interest rates. You see, but this is why it's the rigging of rates, this is what's at the root of all the problems in the world. This is why America isn't very popular with many players around the world today. This is why China wants gold.
Speaking of gold, I wonder if you could tell folks specifically your thoughts on just what all of this could mean to the precious metals markets, and is it a positive in the long term for precious metals investors?
With this kind of knowledge, Chris, if anybody invests the time to understand what's really going on, you will come to realize that the price of gold and the price of precious metals in general are metaphorically like a beach ball being held on the bottom of a pool. And I'll tell you something. The people that are holding the beach ball on the bottom of the pool, they are going to have to come up for air at some point in time, because what they're doing is not sustainable. And when it pops, it's going to pop big.
Is it possible to even forecast what that means in terms of nominal prices?
No, actually, Chris, I'm going to throw a term at you, a reversion to a mean. If you put the last 3,000 years on a yardstick, and if you talk about the amount of time that we've had a pure fiat money standard in the world, you probably have maybe an inch or 2 inches of that 36-inch yardstick where we've had a fiat standard. The rest of the yardstick wealth was measured in ounces. And for many and most of those inches on the yardstick, a very good middle-class wage was somewhere between 40 and 60 ounces of silver. So I think I'm going to live to see the day when 40 to 60 ounces of silver will be a good middle-class wage once again. So why don't you tell me what the price of silver is going to be?
You're talking about four digits. When would you suppose that we left the precious metal standard? I mean, there's so many ways we can look at this. I mean, you can argue that it was Roosevelt. You can even go back to the Federal Reserve. Some people say it was Nixon in 71. Others have said, well, not until most of our 90% silver left circulation were we really off of a gold and silver standard. I'd like your thoughts.
I would suggest we were, in a North American sense, actually probably really in a global sense, was with the gold confiscation in, 1933 or 4. And that to me was an attempt to basically kill the gold standard. Mm-hmm. You know, it's just something that hasn't worked. You see, the current fiat standard, Chris, is going to fail. I can't tell you what day it's going to fail, but I know it will fail. And when it fails, things are going to be thrown into such disarray that people will look for, will end up being forced back to going to things that have worked in the past.
Should we be thinking in terms of that mighty island nation, Great Britain, when its pound no longer was the de facto currency? Or are we looking at something far worse, more sinister? Because this time around, there is virtually not a single currency in circulation backed by anything more than paper promises.
Exactly.
So you referred earlier to Mr. John Williams, a regular and favorite on this show. He thinks precious metals have much room on the upside. He says, Chris, what is a one divided by zero? Because essentially, we're looking at an infinity if you look at where paper money ultimately has to go, which is zero.
Well, it's a hyperinflation.
This term hyperinflation has been thrown around so carelessly. Can you undo some of that damage? I mean, everyone has kind of given up, I think, on the mega inflation theme. Is that going to work to their detriment?
Well, you know what, Chris? I can say this because I've done a little bit of research in the area of hyperinflations. Most hyperinflations, and there's been like hundreds of them, like throughout recorded history. And the one thing they all have in common is that, to characterize them, when they come, they always seem like a lightning bolt out of a clear blue sky, and they come on extremely quickly.
Of course, the Weimar is maybe the most prominent example, but certainly not the worst. I mean, we can talk about Hungary, Czechoslovakia, well, virtually every Central European country.
It's interesting, Chris, you reference Weimar Germany. Why do you think Germany wants their gold back?
That may only be one component, the swapping and interest rate schemes that have gone on there, and they realize that their gold has been rehypothecated probably several times over, because I think they realize that deflation is what we're afraid of, because that's all we've experienced, at least since the Civil War. But inflation is far more nefarious, and it just devastates the middle and working classes.
Absolutely. And you can also rest assured, Chris, it's been the dirty tricks of the Anglo-American banking establishment in an attempt to keep the current system operating, which has enraged German politicians to the point where an adjunct of the German finance ministry called BaFin has now undertaken their own investigation. They've been investigating now for well over a year. And these guys are fiercely independent, and I'm told that these guys, when they have the goods, they will act. And, you know, I think the world will be better served if we end up with a slew of high-profile indictments and a roundup.
Well, you know, Dr. Paul Craig Roberts has gone on record recently. Paris sent back 37 tons. They're finished. Why is it that we're stretching this out over so many years and not making good on our promise? And he draws the inference, is it possible we really don't have the gold? I mean, the physical gold may be there, but our officials recognize that it is simply leased and swapped so many times over that it would send the markets into chaos if we really had to send back 1,500 tons in total. So do you care to put a timeline on this? How long can they hold this inflated beach ball underwater? You say they have to come up for breath.
I've said this before publicly, and you know, I'll say it again because I think it's relevant, and I think it's on the mark. China has been aggressively accumulating gold, and I'll tell you something, Chris. China has a protocol when they do their procurement of gold. Every bar or every ounce of gold that China accumulates is de facto automatically recast and re-refined. Their preferred way of holding gold is in kilo bars. And the reason why they have everything re-refined is because the people advising China have encountered product in the marketplace that isn't gold. It's made of tungsten. You know, I've written about this years ago, and I wrote about this years ago because I know somebody who's in the procurement business internationally, and somebody tried to sell them 50 tons of tungsten. And this person is a very streetwise person and knew that there was something wrong with the supposed goods. There's a lot of tungsten gold siloed in places in our international market.
Well, you know, for our listeners, this is just a bit of anecdotal information, but if you purchase silver bars, you don't have to worry about that. Just take one of those rare earth small magnets, round magnets, and if it rolls just a bit more slowly off of a 100-ounce bar of silver, you can be sure that you have the real thing, because silver is, interestingly enough, slightly magnetic in nature, whereas lead has no magnetic qualities or minuscule. So this is a neat little trick that I've learned over the years, that you can check all of your Engelhard and Johnson Matthey bars quickly with a 10-cent rare earths magnet. If it rolls slowly, then it's silver. If it rolls off quickly, you may have a lead bar.
One more thing I just wanted to throw in on top of that. People would also be wise to pay attention that the gold that Germany, the pittance that they have been managed to get back.
Yeah, 5 tons.
They've recast it. They've recast it all. What I would like to mention to people is that the people advising the Germans are the same people that are advising the Chinese.
Can you tell folks more about the services that you provide? Any blogs, websites, or any contact information you'd like to leave with the listeners today?
Yeah, well, you can find me on the web at KirbyAnalytics.com. I tend to, in recent months, Chris, I've been writing a lot less publicly, as in trying not to write publicly, and I've been trying to communicate directly with my clients. So. And I'm also involved in the bullion business. I'm a sales agent for a company named BMG, Bullion Management.
We're going to look forward to having you back on GoldSeek.com radio.
And I look forward to it, Chris. Nice to have had the time with you.
Okay, it's great to be back with you at GoldSeek.com radio for another Gold Nugget segment. Today's special guest, Prue Saxena from Prue Saxena Wealth Management. it's a pleasure to welcome back to the show Peru Saxena, the founder and CEO of Peru Saxena Wealth Management based in Hong Kong. Welcome back, Peru.
My pleasure, Chris.
You know, I'd like to begin, if we could, with the precious metals sector. How long have you been coming on the show? It has to be seven or eight years now, Peru. I know that you have been somewhat down on the sector. You were correct all throughout most of 2013. So far, though, 2014 is shaping up, at least early on, to be quite an improvement over last year for gold investors. So I'd like your analysis on the sector and whether or not you buy this market bottom hypothesis.
Well, sure, Chris. We got out of precious metals in September, October 2011 and stayed out of the sector all throughout, and only recently, earlier in the month, we've got a buy signal again on both gold as well as silver. So we are now back in the bullish camp. We think that the market has made a valid double bottom. And if you look at the price of gold as well as silver, and most importantly, the miners, all of them have now gone above all the key moving averages, something which hasn't happened in a long time. If you look at the price of gold, it is trading above the 200-day moving average. Silver is also trading above the 200-day moving average. And the MS Gold Bugs Index is also trading above the 200 moving average, given the fact that the precious metal sector was so bombed out. There is a real possibility of a tradable rally here. I'm not going to put my neck out and say, well, how high is it going to go and how long is it going to go on for? I'd leave that to some of the other people. But all I see is positive price action. The charts are telling us that we've had some sort of a bottom in place, whether it was the bottom, I don't really know. But all I do know is that the trend is up for now. And this is a good low-risk entry point to buy the metals, or if you own some, to accumulate some more.
We see identical things in the market, but we see it from a slightly different vantage point. I mean, you're following the 200-period moving average on the daily chart, would be my guess. I follow the 50-period moving average on the weekly chart. Technically speaking, I just see fireworks ahead. We've seen a rounding bottom here, just like we saw, I think, in 2008. Once again, the XAU and the miners are leading the way. We like to see during bull markets, as I know you follow as well, relative strength in the equities compared with bullion. They tend to lead the market, and that is certainly a big positive. They were remarkably oversold, hitting 80-90% off on many of these top names, some of which have fantastic earnings, revenues, discounted cash flow numbers. And another interesting aspect here, we're starting to see some developments in the U.S. dollar. You know, the greenback breaking through some key support, a lot of sluggishness and weakness. It's had 3 years to put in a bottom, just hasn't been able to maintain any momentum on the upside. I'd like your comments on the greenback, please.
The greenback has weakened as well, you're right. If you look at the U.S. dollar index on the daily chart, you'll note that it's actually hit the 200-day moving average a couple of times and it's come right back down again. And at the moment, it is trading below the 50-day, below the 100-day, below the 200-day moving averages. And the trend is down for now. How long the dollar will continue to deteriorate, Chris, I don't have a clue. At the moment, the European currencies are strong. If you look at the British pound, you look at the euro, the Swiss franc, they are doing very well. If you look at some of the other currencies, such as the Canadian dollar, the Aussie dollar, to me, at least, they look vulnerable. The Canadian dollar has recently broken through a very important support level, which goes back several years. So usually whenever this kind of price action takes place, you get further movement in that direction. So I think the Canadian dollar will probably deteriorate from here. But the U.S. dollar also looks pretty weak right now. The European currencies look strong to me.
I'd like to shift the conversation over to the silver market. You know, some analysts have pegged the cost of mining silver at around the $20 an ounce level, but prices, of course, declined much lower recently. In January, demand for silver coins sold by the U.S. Mint also quadrupled over the previous figure. Some sources are claiming that mine production may have been disrupted somewhat by these lower prices, as the cost, of course, to produce is essentially a bit higher than the actual spot price.
Well, silver is high beta play on gold. As you know, Chris, you've been following this market for a long time. Whenever the price of gold goes in any direction, silver tends to follow, but with high octane. If you look at silver, silver fell from $50 per ounce to about $20 per ounce. That is a massive smash. And now if you have some real upside in gold, then I think silver may outperform on the upside. This is just the nature of the beast. You know, if you've got money and you are prepared for the volatility, then you go and buy some silver. But I would urge your readers not to get too excited and put everything they own in silver, because when you have moves in silver, they can be exhilarating on both sides. So just be sensible, buy the amount that you can keep without getting shaken out by the market.
Sales of the American Eagle gold coins, as well as silver coins, have been up sharply, but particularly on silver. The U.S. Mint showing a 63% increase. That's the highest quite some time, quadrupling again. Actually, one reporter there said that they're struggling to meet demand. There seems to be some tie-in here with record demand for silver in India, import curbs on gold, the yellow metal, for quite some time, and there's some talk of that unwinding in 2014. Any thoughts on the Indian import curbs?
Well, I don't really know what's going on over there, but Chris, anything that is related to demand or supply is already in the price. If you look at the price today, you know, the price around $21 an ounce or 22, whatever it is today, is indicative of everything every market participant knows about the supply and demand. The price is always right, and, you know, there may be changes which may occur in the future, but if you don't know about that today, there is no point forecasting it. If there was any bullish development in India or elsewhere, I would have imagined that the price would have already gone up in anticipation of that. So I generally tend to follow price. For me, price is king, and everything else is just noise. So, you know, maybe there may be changes in China or India. I don't really know. All I do is I just follow price, and the zig and zags on the price. But if you also look at the metals, they had a big smash from 2011 until recently. Prices were down. Everybody was buying, or at least people who were excited about the sector were buying. But sellers clearly dominated this market for almost 3 years or 2.5 years. Now we've seen changes in the supply and demand dynamics. Buyers seem to be in control at the moment. Perhaps precious metals became too cheap. Perhaps the market is not concerned now about the tapering. People believe that the economy is not as strong as that they previously believed. Therefore, they think that the tapering is either going to be reduced or withdrawn. And perhaps that is why the metals are going up, and that's why the U.S. dollar is coming down. I don't really know, Chris. I'm just speculating here. I just think that investors are not so sanguine about the state of the world economy now as they were several months ago. I think people are worried that there may be a slowdown of some sorts coming, maybe some problems in China. Who knows? But people are going back into the metals, and that's what is important.
Well, let's also take a look at the Fed's balance sheet. I know that you watch it closely. If you look at the steepness of the ascent, the Fed now has reached about $4.2 trillion on the Fed's balance sheet. You know, all this talk of tapering, it doesn't seem to be showing up in their bottom line. They dropped from about $85 billion, I think, a month to roughly $65 billion, about dropping $10 billion at each FOMC meeting now. That's two in a row. So do you expect Janet Yellen to continue with this process of tapering? What could that mean to this precious metals nascent recovery?
Well, Chris, if you look at the Fed's balance sheet, the Fed's balance sheet is still expanding because the Fed is still buying additional bonds every month. They may have reduced the rate of purchase or the amount of purchase each month, but they are still net buyers of fixed income securities. That's why the Fed's balance sheet is going up. When they stop a QE altogether and when they start selling those securities, that's when you're going to see a contraction in the Fed's balance sheet. Now, when that will happen, nobody knows. But when that happens, that will be the time to be extremely careful for all assets, because when the Fed's balance sheet contracts and the Fed funds rate goes up and there's genuine monetary contraction, I suspect every asset class, including gold, silver, stocks, property, art, wine, everything will take a big hit. And that will be the time to be in U.S. dollar cash or long-dated U.S. Treasury securities. If you look at credit crunches, whenever you have liquidity withdrawn from the system, if you remember the 2008 crisis, you will recall that gold, silver, everything fell except bonds, government bonds, and U.S. dollars. I think something similar will play out in the future. So you got to watch the Fed's balance sheet carefully and see whether money is being added into the system or dollars are being removed from the system. As long as dollars are being added, you can be long precious metals or you can be long stocks and everything else. But when the tide reverses, you will have to be very careful. And I think the yield curve will also signal at some point that a contraction is coming. If there is a big recession or a bear market coming, I think you're going to get the inversion of the yield curve, and that would be the time to head for the hills.
I'm a bit skeptical with regard to a repeat of 2008. I mean, you might recall that the Fed's balance sheet went up sharply right around that 2008-2009 level. How would bonds and treasuries hold up under such a scenario?
Well, Chris, if you've got a recovery in housing in America, and housing already bottomed out 2 years ago, and if house prices keep going up, not only in America, but also in Europe, and in also some of the bombed out countries in Europe, such as Greece, etc., then, you know, housing is a big employment generator. And we've had this thesis for 2 years. You know, we felt 2 years ago that housing in the U.S. was bottoming out. Indeed, prices have risen over the last 18 months or so. And if housing continues to improve in the U.S., which is a multi-year cycle, then more and more people are going to get back into the workforce and the consumer spending will increase, prices will go up, the underwater mortgages, the negative equity will disappear. I've seen this experience firsthand in Hong Kong. I mean, we had a similar crash in 1997, but ours was even worse. Prices fell by about 60-65% in real estate. And it took maybe several years for things to get back to normal, but they did get back to normal. And I think in America also, things will get back to normal. It's just a question of time. And when prices go up and negative equities disappear, Chris, people are going to start coming back and spending. Credit creation will pick up. And then inflation will go up, and then you'll get the next cycle of monetary tightening. So it's just a cycle. Markets go up, they go down. You know, we just have to align ourselves with the right direction, that's all. The reason behind the housing recovery is threefold. One is the monetary policy. You know, when interest rates are so low, people who don't really own a real estate and people who are not underwater, they come back and they get attracted by the cheap interest rates and they borrow and they invest and speculate in property. That's what is happening. And if you also look at the supply of the physical properties, you know, there has not been a lot of construction in the U.S. now for several years. And household formation in the U.S. Has continued. So, you know, you've got supply and demand issues. You've got the monetary juice or the monetary stimulus, the cheap credit, which is now freely flowing and available. It's only a question of people feeling confident enough to borrow again, and borrow again they will. History suggests that. So these are the three reasons why the housing market, in my view, is going to continue to appreciate for the next 4 or 5 years in the U.S. and also throughout much of the developed world.
Well, it certainly would be great news for the economy, and of course, the stock market tends to be highly correlated with the sector as well. So, you know, I can see where you're headed. The only wrench that I think I could throw into the mechanism there, you talk about this lack of physical supply, but for, according to my insider sources, there's roughly 18 million empty homes, and I'm not just talking about houses, we're talking about rentals as well, on this market. That would seem to me to be quite a surfeit, and it could actually put downward pressure on prices in the next few years. That's the only caveat, but I think we've covered that pretty well. Let's move back to the precious metal sector, because that's what our listeners are most interested in today. You know, UBS, the investment bank, has changed their target. They're looking for $1,300 gold by the end of the year. Another couple of investment bankers are also calling for higher precious metals. Citigroup saying that gold is likely bottomed in this cycle, mostly due to increased demand in China. Any thoughts?
Well, as I said, I think the prices seem to have bottomed out for now. Whether or not this is sustainable, I don't really know. But I do know that as long as the metals and the related miners, Chris, stay above the key moving day averages, then you should be long the uptrend and you should stay with the course, you know, not get shaken out by the news. So that's my view at the moment. I think, you know, the tide has turned for the metals after 2.5 years. It's not a bad idea to own some metals.
This time around, as the precious metals are rebounding, we also have a strong stock market as well as a strong housing market. We never saw that over the 12-year gold bull market. Okay, we saw a stagnation in stocks. They never broke out to new highs. And we saw a housing market that, for the most part, suffered at least from, let's say, 2006, 2007. What do you think could be the driver that sends precious metals back to, let's say, just their former 2011 highs?
Chris, that's why, if you recall, I've been very guarded with my assessment of precious metals, because I know that gold is a counter-cyclical asset, so it tends to do well when the economy is weak, and that's why it did really well in the last decade. As you rightly point out, stocks are rising, things are getting better in the West, housing is on the way up, and precious metals have also had a bounce. That's why I'm not so sure about the durability or sustainability of this bounce. You know, I would be happy if it continues to go up, because I'll make money. But as you said, you know, everything can't go up at the same time. Gold has gone up last decade because of the fear factor. It was a fear trade. Now fear is just going away from the markets and the economy. Things are healing in the West. So, you know, time will only tell whether all three asset classes can go up together or not. You know, that's why I'm being very guarded and a bit careful with my assessments. I don't want to, mislead your readers into believing that I'm extremely bullish and gung-ho about the metals and that they're going to blast through their old highs. I just don't know at this stage. That's why I'm just taking it one day at a time and just seeing how things play out.
Okay, so I think it would be safe to say that you're cautiously optimistic at this point. And then what would be, let's say, a key resistance level that the metals would need to eclipse to put you firmly back in the bullish camp, please?
Well, I am bullish because I'm long metals. You know, we've got a system, our trend following system has given us a buy, so we never fight the system. We've bought the metals. And I think, you know, as long as the trend stays up and they stay above the 200-day moving average, which for me really is the key, then you should stay long. The overhead resistances, there are plenty of levels, so they're not really that important in my mind. I think what matters is that they should hold definitely above the 200-day moving average, because if any pullback fails to hold above that level and prices go down again, to my mind, this would have been nothing more than a relief rally, and I will get out again. I don't want to be in any position where I lose money and see the loss get bigger and bigger. So everybody has different trading philosophies. From our point of view, we protect each and every single position with a strict protective trailing stop. And if the metals start to weaken again and things go bad, we will just get out and move on to the next thing. You know, I'm not married to gold or silver or anything else. I'm in this game to make money.
Anything else on your radar screen that you're watching you'd like to share with the listeners today?
Yeah, well, Chris, I have spent 15 years in this business, and I've learned from my own painful experience that the market is always right. Your opinion can be wrong, your judgment can be wrong, your biases can be wrong, but the price never lies. The price is the truth. If you are bullish and the price keeps going down and down and down, the price isn't wrong. The market knows more than anybody else, and people who are confident and arrogant in this business and people who believe that they know the best don't do very well, and they don't last. A few years ago, and I realized you cannot be brave and arrogant in this business, because so from my point of view, you know, I generally now try and avoid making extremely high conviction forecasts, because I just know from experience that eventually one day I will be wrong. And then that would be the end of it for me. And I don't want to put myself or our investors in that position. That's why we, you know, don't allocate too much to one sector. And whenever we put on a trade on stocks or metals or anything else, we always protect each and every single position with a strict trailing stop loss. And once we are in a trade, we never ever meddle with it. We have an automated trading system which gets us out at the right time by a trailing stop. So once we're in it, we have absolutely no discretion on when we exit. The price tells us and the volatility tells us when to exit and cover the position, whether it is at a big profit or at a small loss. But what we try and do, Chris, is to avoid the big loss. You know, if you are wrong and if you lose 7 or 8 or 10%, you only need to make about 10% to get back your capital. If you lose 50%, you need to double your money to get back to starting point. So you've got to avoid the big losses in this business. And the only way to do that is to protect the downside, to diversify, to spread your eggs in different baskets and watch all of them very carefully. You don't put all your money in one asset. You don't put anything that you own in silver or gold. And you don't hope and pray. That's not the way to invest. That's the way to the poorhouse. You want to diversify. You want to protect your positions. And you want to have a sensible approach and not have such a high conviction that you just don't see what is really happening in the markets. And the price, in my view, Chris, never ever lies.
Well, I only wish that I had asked you to write the foreword for Wealth Building Strategies, because it is a perfect synopsis of my thoughts and has been ever since the dot-com implosion. At the risk of getting a bit academic, there was a brilliant statistician in England who proved over many, many experiments that the collective guesses of individuals always better than anyone, even the outliers at the edge of the bell curve, of the Gaussian curve. Let's say, for instance, we have a jar of marbles. I take this jar of marbles to 300 or 400 people all throughout the city and just ask them for their guess. You're going to have outliers of 5,000 and outliers of 50. But by the time they're all averaged together, these guesses are all averaged, you're going to be close to 99% accurate, even higher, more like 99.6% in almost every single time you run this test. Every day, the closing market price is the best guess of millions of people. And that's why your point, I think, is so salient, and I hope that it hits home with all our listeners, because if you can just accept the fact that no one knows more than the market, then you start to set up these investing parameters that Peru has mentioned, such as limiting your losses generally to 5% on any one trade, and certainly no more than of your total portfolio of more than 1% or 2% on any individual trade, and let your winners run for as long as possible, trailing out of them on swing lows, for instance. It's just a fantastic way to preserve your capital, and your portfolio will thank you. Okay, Peru, we'll look forward to having you back on GoldSeek.com radio. Thanks.
So anytime, Chris. Thank you very much. It's always a pleasure talking to you.
Hey, Chris. This is Robert Ian with ConquerChange.com. Throughout my career as a business motivational speaker, I have commanded $5,000 honorariums, $10,000 honorariums, but I have never commanded a $250,000 honorarium. In fact, very few speakers or celebrities command fees of $250,000 for a 40-minute presentation. But that's exactly what our former Fed chairman, Uncle Ben Bernanke, received for a 40-minute speech in Abu Dhabi last Tuesday. And this was the first of three such speeches around the world this past week. It's great work if you can get it. Considering the fact his published salary for 2013 was $199,700. Our good, or not-so-good friend, Sir Alan Greenspan, hit the speaking circuit less than 1 week after departing his role as Fed chairman. His first speech brought in $250,000 with an added live video conference for high-roller Japanese investors for another $120,000. Adjusting for inflation, Greenspan's one-day speaking fees were over $430,000. Our other good friend, former Treasury Secretary Timmy Boy Geithner, reportedly made $400,000 for three speeches. He, like Bernanke, is writing a book. Greenspan recently released one. I love public speaking because it reflects the true supply and demand demographics of a very limited marketplace, that of the individual, and the value and uniqueness of their topic or message. I do not begrudge Ben, Alan, or Timmy 1 cent of their honorariums. In fact, I encourage them to charge as much as the market will pay them. Why? Because inflation is accelerating at a faster and faster rate. Another former Fed chairman, Paul Volcker, once quipped he could make a year's salary, which in 1987 was approximately $80,000, by giving a speech or two. Now Bernanke is receiving triple that amount for a single speech. Two Bernanke speeches would be $500,000. Now triple that amount heading into the future, and you're at $1.5 million. If there's any questions on where inflation is really headed, we'll just cross-check the future speaker honorariums of former Fed chairmen with today's speaking fees. My guess is the calculation will be both surprisingly accurate and shockingly high. And until next time, this is Robert Ian with ConquerChange.com, reminding you to follow us on Twitter @ConquerChange. Thanks, Chris.